Το πρόβλημα να μπουν στο meeting. Ζητάμε συγγνώμη, ήταν μια τεχνική βλάβη, αποκαταστήθηκε, άρα μπορούμε να συνεχίσουμε. Λοιπόν, για όσους δεν με ξέρετε, να ξανασυστηθώ, γιατί το έκανα άλλη μια φορά νωρίτερα. Είμαι ο Μάξος Κουλάκης, σας μιλάω από το ΚΕΒΕ Φλέμινγκ στη Βάρη, από το Ινστιτούτο Βασικής Βιοιατρικής Έρευνας, στο οποίο είναι και η Κατερίνα Παπανικολοπούλου που θα μας μιλήσει σήμερα. Η Κατερίνα είναι ερευνήτρια Σταύρος Νιάρχος στο Ινστιτούτο μας. Η Κατερίνα είναι χημικός και δομική βιολόγος, που το 2006 αποφάσισε ότι χρειάζεται κάτι live στη ζωή της και αποφάσισε να ασχοληθεί με τα όπαθη σε ένα μοντέλο, σε ένα οργανισμό μοντέλο που μπορείς να κάνεις πολλά πράγματα και που, δεν είναι, που μπορεί να μετρήσει κανείς και μάθηση και μνήμη και όλα τα άλλα που μπορούμε να κάνουμε στη μήκα. Κατερίνα, δεν θέλω να πω τίποτα άλλο. Τα υπόλοιπα θα σας τα πει η ίδια. Ελπίζω το overview που θα σας δείξει να σας ικανοποιήσει και να ξεκινήσουν ερωτήσεις. Κατερίνα.
So again, thank you all for being here with us to an afternoon full of tau, the protein to which my research is committed. I'm going to give you an overall overview of what we are doing here at Fleming and a brief introduction on tau. Tau is a microtubule-associated protein that is mainly found in neuronal axons. There are six tau isoforms present in the adult human brain generated from alternative splicing of a single copy gene. They differ in the number of N-terminal inserts, 0, 1, or 2, and in the number of microtubule binding repeats, 3 or 4. Tau undergoes a variety of post-translational modifications that regulate its function, and for example, phosphorylation decreases the affinity of tau for microtubules. Even though the main functions of tau in the brain remain to be defined, there is no question that tau is involved in a variety of disabling brain disorders grouped under the term tauopathies. And even all tauopathies share a filamentous pathology made of abnormally phosphorylated tau, or as we say, hyperphosphorylated. They are otherwise distinguished in that different brain regions and nerve cell types are affected. Also, the isoform composition of aggregates is different. There are also mutations in the tau gene linked to FTTDP17. They cluster in the microtubule binding region of tau, and most of them enhance the aggregation propensity of tau. There are also non-coding mutations that affect the splicing of exon 10. So we have the production of more 4R isoforms than 3R isoforms. Tau has been studied for more than 30 years, particularly since it was coined to be the major component of neurofibrillary tangles. And its importance was further emphasized by the discovery of FTTP17 mutations. However, tau still remains poorly understood, and there is a huge knowledge gap in both its normal biological functions and in the molecular mechanisms of tau-mediated toxicity and death. Why this is happening? The first reason is because the combination of alternative splicing with site-specific post-translational modifications gives rise to an enormous heterogeneity of individual tau molecules. And even though we tend to treat tau as if it was one protein, tau is not one protein. What do we want from our model systems? We want them to develop tangles fast and to develop cognitive deficits fast. So for that reason, the majority of model systems use isoforms of tau that carry FTTDP17-associated mutations. And then we usually tend to extrapolate the results in an Alzheimer's disease context. But is that a right thing to do? And of course, that is a rhetorical question. the third reason is that here we are today at 2021 with all that knowledge accumulated. And our problem right now is not that we are not aware of mechanisms that might contribute to neuronal dysfunction. It is the opposite. We have too many. We have a plethora of abnormal tau species and mechanisms, and we do not know which one of them is the most important for the evolution of pathology. Let me introduce you to some key questions of the tau field. What are the roles of tau's post-translational modifications in both health and disease? What is the biochemical identity of toxic tau? Is it monomers, multimers, oligomers, fibrillar, non-fibrillar? Of course, what is the role and the impact of tau spreading for neuronal survival and brain functions? And finally, assuming that tau adopts a toxic identity, what are the downstream mechanisms? What happens next, actually? And here is us at Fleming, working with tau using Drosophila as a model system. And I have divided our research in three groups. The first group has to do with fundamental tau biology. And to do that, we have adopted the most common technique, work with Drosophila tau null mutants. And also, we are particularly interested in the functional differentiation of the six human tau isoforms. So why we have six isoforms? The second group has to do with the $1 million question, how does tau kill the neuron? And in the third group, what we're actually trying to do is to try to outline the cascade of events. What triggers neurodegeneration? What follows next? And what are the endpoints? And to do that, we use a proteomic approach. And the use of proteomics can contribute to two aspects of tau research. First, the recognition of proteins that can help elucidate the pathways leading to tau pathology. And second, the development of biomarkers. So let's start with the first group, very quickly about Drosophila tau. Drosophila tau has a high degree of similarity with the human one. Of course, it interacts with microtubules. It is mainly expressed in the head of the flies, and it is phosphorylated, as revealed by the shift in the molecular weight upon treatment with lambda phosphatase. What do we have? We have completely de-tau null mutants, so flies that do not express at all tau. And what we did is a whole brain proteome analysis of these mutants. This is a volcano plot. Let me guide you through the plot. So below this line, you can see the proteins whose levels are not altered upon the tau loss. And you can see here, for example, that the levels of ensconcin and FUCH, these are the fly homologs of MAP7 and MAP1, are not altered. On your right side of the screen, you can see the proteins that are upregulated in the mutant, and on the left side, the proteins that are downregulated. So you can see that the vast majority of the proteins is upregulated, and you can see that loss of the tau has an impact on the levels of beta tubulin and alpha tubulin, and we have shown on microtubules as well. But since HDAC6 is downregulated, so the enzyme that deacetylates microtubules are more acetylated and more stable. Loss of the tau has a huge impact on the stability of filamentous actin as well. You can see a greater destabilization of filamentous actin in the mutants. We have done a functional enrichment analysis of the proteins that change in the mutant, and that has revealed the involvement of Drosophila tau in translation. and to confer interesting, all the proteins here are upregulated in the mutant. And to confirm that there is upregulated translation in the mutant, we did a functional assay that pyromycin incorporation. So you can see in the D-tau-null mutants a robust pyromycin incorporation and increased protein synthesis. And then we tested whether Drosophila tau is involved in behavioral plasticity. And for that, we used the classical conditional olfactory paradigm in which we train flies to associate an odor with electric shock. So odor A with electric shock, odor B without electric shock. That's the training. And then we test flies by letting them choose between odor A and odor B. And the normal thing to do is to go towards odor B. So if testing occurs immediately after training, then we have a shorter memory learning. If testing occurs after 24 hours, then it's long-lasting memories and long-term memory, a memory phase that depends on de novo protein synthesis. And then we tested habituation. Habituation is a non-associative behavior that is manifested as a decreased response to a repetitive stimulus, meaning that we start to shock the flies, and flies at the beginning avoid the shock, but then they start to habituate to it and they stop avoiding it. And that's the normal thing to do. However, our D-tau null mutants failed to habituate to shock. No matter what, they keep avoiding the shock. D-tau loss has no effect in the learning performance of the mutants. Mutants learn equally well with control flies. And interestingly, the show enhanced long-term memory. So we have all these very clean and robust molecular and behavioral phenotypes on one hand. And on the other hand, what we are trying to do is to differentiate functionally the six human tau isoforms. So we do that in two backgrounds, and in the D-tau KO genetic background. So, and we are trying to see which isoforms rescues the behavioral and molecular types associated with the loss of Drosophila tau. And we are also doing that in a wild-type background. I would dare to say that this is an old approach and this is a quite new approach in our lab. The tools that we use, so Drosophila offers a number of readouts of tau toxicity. And the first one is the retinal toxicity observed in adult flies as a RAFI phenotype. When we express tau in the central nervous system, there is one particular neuronal type that it is affected, and these are the mushroom bodies. They are the functional analog of the vertebrate hippocampus. And the phenotype is isoform specific. Here you can see normal mushroom bodies and ablated mushroom bodies upon 0 and 4 hour and 24 hour expression. Of course, we measure the longevity of the flies. How many flies reach adulthood, the resistance of flight to different kinds of stresses, heat stress, oxidative stress. Mobility impairments are revealed by the climbing activity of the flies. And of course, we assess their cognitive functions using the paradigm that I have talked to you before. And this is a very small overview of already published work between 3 and 4 repeat human tau. And to summarize, 0 and 3 hour expression causes mostly axonal transport defects and impairment in locomotion, whereas expression of 4 hour isoform causes more extensive neurodegeneration and leads to learning and memory impairments. We are going to the second group of our research, which is the most extensive one, I would dare to say. So what happens when we express human tau in the adult central nervous system of Drosophila? And to do that, we are using an inducible system. So when we raise flies at 18 degrees, the expression of tau is off. And when we transfer flies from 18 to 30 degrees, we induce the expression of the transgene. You can see here the expression of tau at 10 days of at 30 degrees. We reach, I think, a plateau of the quantity. And then we have the appearance of disease-associated phosphoepitopes. You can see that there are phosphorylation sites that appear at the first day of tau expression, phosphorylation sites that appear after 10 days of expression, and then there is one phosphorylation at serine 238 that appears really late after 20 days of expression. And at 22 days, the 50% of the flies start to die. Interestingly, learning and memory impairments appear only after 12 days of induction and not earlier. Okay. So we are here and we wonder what is going to happen if we decide to shut down the expression of tau, meaning that if we transfer flies back to 18 degrees. So this is the way the experiment was designed. Flies at 18 degrees, we put them for 10 days at 30, and then we switch off the expression of tau for 10 days by putting flies back at 18 degrees. And there is the second group that we use as control. So the flies stay at 18 degrees and we put them for 12 days at 30. And what we observe is that when we switch off the expression of tau, the long-term memory deficits are reversible. And for us, this was really important because it showed that the central nervous system is not permanently damaged. So this is a great platform for drug screening. We have a quite big library of chemical compounds. And actually, the only thing that we need is luck, I suppose. What happens to our friends, the aggregates? So this is the soluble fraction and this is the insoluble. When we shut down the expression of tau, aggregates do not disappear. I could say the opposite. We see an increase in their levels. However, cognitive function is regained. And this is really surprising because this is a general finding that has been observed in too many transgenic models of tauopathies, that when we switch off the expression of tau, neuronal function is regained despite the presence of neurofibrillary tangles. And this is a question food for thought, let's say. It's a rhetoric question. What if we should put more effort in trying to lower overall tau levels as a therapeutic approach, because this approach will have a great advantage. It will bypass the question of which forms of tau and which downstream mechanisms are most detrimental. And now we are going to the most important post-translational modification of tau, phosphorylation. And I have to say that we have put a lot of effort, time, and money in order to understand if it is hyperphosphorylation per se that makes tau a toxic protein, or if there are particular phosphorylation sites that contribute to the evolution of pathology. And to do that, we have used phosphorylation mutants of disease-associated epitopes. These threonines and serines have been mutated either to alanines or to glutamic acid in order to mimic phosphorylation. And in order to make a very long story short, I have to say that yes, there are specific sites that when phosphorylated make tau a toxic protein, and it is not phosphorylation per se that mediates tau toxicity. We observe that tau toxicity and dysfunction are controlled by different phosphorylation sites. When serine-262 is present, then tau-expressing flies always present cognitive deficits. We have more than 50 tau transgenic lines, and that rule has never been broken. When serine-262 phosphorylation is absent, then the learning performance of the animals is normal. In flies, neurotoxicity is mediated by phosphorylation at serine-238. And quite interestingly, we have observed a gatekeeping effect. What does it mean? That in order for serine-238 to be phosphorylated, serine-262 needs to be phosphorylated first. We also know the gatekeeper of serine-262. It is threonine-245. And we have produced the antibody that recognizes phosphorylation at serine-238. And we have studied human samples, and we have observed that phosphorylation at serine-238 characterizes tau in Alzheimer's disease, Fuchs disease, FTD and the progressive supranuclear palsy, and is always absent from non-dimetic control subjects. Interestingly, we have found that, actually it is in the bibliography, that serine-238 is one of the few serines and threonines that are glycosylated in tau. And glycosylation is the opposite of phosphorylation. So when serine-238 is glycosylated, it cannot be phosphorylated. So we thought that it was going to be a great idea to also produce the antibody that recognizes glycosylated serine-238. And even though phosphoserine-238 antibody recognizes neurofibular rectangles and big bodies, this is not the case for glycosylated serine-238. And we truly believe that the ratio of the two antibodies could serve as a great potential predictive marker of tauopathy. And we plan to do that in the future. So from phosphorylation to metals, it has long been suspected a correlation between tau, metals, and oxidative stress. Neurofibrillary rectangles are major centers of redox activity, and it was known that iron affects the phosphorylation state of tau and increases its aggregation propensity. And if tau is indeed a metalloprotein, then where is the binding site? And back in the middle 90s, there is a group that showed that when they chemically modified histidines in neurofibrillary rectangles, then they can no more bind iron. So we said, okay, histidines. And when we looked in the structure of tau, these are the four macrotubule binding repeats. You can see five histidines, and the one is conserved among the four repeats. So we decided to mutate one, the blue one, so the first of the two, HH, a double mutant, and a triple mutant. That histidine, that one, and that one in the fourth macrotubule binding repeat. So we have a single, a double, and triple mutant. And the question was, okay, let's mutate histidine to which amino acid? We had two options, either phenylalanines to mimic the shape of histidine, and either lysine to mimic the charge of histidine. And because the choice was not obvious, and we decided to do both, and because that's the advantage of working with flies, I just need to remind you that a transgenic fly costs around $180. Okay, and Quite interestingly, these mutations completely abolished the toxicity of tau in vivo. I will just show here, this is a metal binding assay. So when you mix tau with metal coated beads, and these are the beads that we all use for the purification of histad proteins, okay? Then tau is bound on these beads. But either lysine or phenylalanine mutants, it's exactly the same. They lose this ability to bind on the metal coated beads. And also, a very brief overview. There is a huge effect on the phosphorylation status of the protein and disease-associated epitopes. The aggregation propensity of tau diminishes, and the flies present no cognitive impairment and no lethality. This is the same for both mutants, phenylalanine and lysine, meaning that neither the charge nor the shape of histidine matter, but only its metal binding properties. We were also really interested in the cysteine residues of tau. Tau has two cysteines. One is located in the second macrotubule binding repeat, so it is present only in 4R isoforms, and the second one is present on the third macrotubule binding repeat and is present in all 6 isoforms. This is the recently solved structure of tau in the neurofibular rectangles, and this is where we observed that the two cysteines are not functionally equivalent. Cysteine 3-2 is incorporated into the core of the fibrils, whereas cysteine 2-NAN1 is disordered and located in the fascic coat. Cysteines are known to be important for the aggregation of tau because in vitro it has been shown that they form disulfide-linked dimers, and in that way they promote the aggregation of tau. So we wanted to see whether the two cysteines are functionally equivalent, and also because cysteine 3-2 exists in all 6 isoforms and cysteine 2-NAN1 exists in 4R isoforms, maybe they could define also isoform-specific differences. And again, to make a long story short, because this work has just been published, yes, cysteine define isoform-specific differences. It is really amazing that when we mutate cysteine 2-NAN1 to alanine, 4R tau starts to behave like a 3R isoform. And their substitution was sufficient to alleviate tau neurotoxicity in vivo. Cysteines have a huge impact in the interaction of tau with macrotubules and a huge impact in the phosphorylation status of the protein. But particularly cysteine 3-2 regulates tau stability via lysine ubiquitination. That was a big proteomic experiment where we managed to spot the lysines that are affected. And actually, it is quite interesting because they are the lysines which are just downstream cysteine 3-2. It has also a huge effect in the aggregation propensity of tau and on tau toxicity. And finally, in our proteomic experiments, we truly believe in an interspecies approach. We are using not only Drosophila fly models, but also a mouse model. It's the Davis mouse. It expresses no human tau, but expresses all 6 human tau isoforms. So we are characterizing changes in the interactome of tau and in the brain proteome in both models at different time points, very early in the disease at non-asymptomatic stages, at the onset of behavioral deficits, for example, 12 days for the flies or 9 months for the mice, and in very aged degenerative animals. We focus in the proteins that co-vary in both systems, because for us right now, it is the only way to narrow down in an unbiased way the long data sets, the long proteomic data sets. And then we take our best candidates and we go to human samples in order to validate these changes. And if they are true, then we go back, particularly to Drosophila, because then we want to genetically dissect that interaction. So I'm going to show you a very preliminary experiment in flies, where we have three groups of flies that are raised at 18 degrees, so no tau expression. And then we put them at 30 degrees, either for 4 days, 8 days, or 12 days. Tau is flagged up, and we immunoprecipitate. And then that's the result of the interactome. This is a heat map in red, the proteins that are, let's say, upregulated. And in green, the proteins that are at lower levels. And you can see that there are interactions that decay over time. So from red become green. And there are interactions that increase over time. From green, they become red. And functional enrichment analysis revealed that the proteins in the 4 days up group, these proteins, encompass more the cytosol and the cytoskeleton, whereas in the 12 days up group, there is a burst of mitochondrial proteins and a very large group of synaptic proteins. And I'm going to show you our lucky guess from the proteomic experiments. And that is Michael. Michael is an enzyme. It is a monooxygenase that actually oxidizes, it can oxidize either methionines or cysteines, and it oxidizes the methionine 44 of actin, and that leads to this disassembly of actin filaments. And very quickly, I'm going to show you that Michael has a huge impact on the aggregation propensity of tau. So when we downregulate Michael, tau does not form aggregates. And we have too many genetic studies, behavioral, and it's a very big work. And that shows that actually Michael talks to cysteine 322. However, the take-home message of this work is that the cysteine's residues of tau act as redox switches. And if one can modulate the redox state of the cysteines, he can modulate the toxicity and dysfunction of the protein. And here is what we found in human samples. This is these are non-dementent controls. This is their age. And you can see here patients with Pick's disease. In all of them, Michael is upregulated. The same is true for patients with Alzheimer's disease and frontotemporal dementia. And here you can see Michael colocalizing with Pick bodies. And that was the overview of our work. This is us at Fleming. I'm sure that you all know Makis as a scientist, but you may not know that Makis has outstanding mentoring qualities. These are current and past members of his lab that have contributed to the work I have talked to you about. And this is my small group, small but miraculous. And our long-lasting collaborators, the proteomic facility at Fleming, Martina Samitaki. And thank you all. And we are ready for questions.
Thank you very much, Katerina. That was great. Anybody that has questions, I don't see anything in the chat. So
I want to ask.
Plenty.
I have a question?
Please.
I wanted to ask two questions. Do you think that glucose metabolism can play a role in the, let's say, pathology of tau-related pathology. That's the one. The second is the whether there is evidence that we have changes in the redox state of the cytoplasm in diseases like Alzheimer's disease and others that you saw that mica is upregulated. And of course, I liked a lot the change in the enrichment of genes towards the mitochondria function or structure associated genes, for which I would like to hear a comment, if you please. Thank you.
Thank you, Spiro.
So, there is oxidative stress. So, that's a general, let's say, fact. And if it is the cause, the consequence, it's another story. But there is oxidative stress. So yes, I think that there is an alteration in the redox state of the cell. The first question was on the glucose metabolism. So I don't work on the glucose metabolism. And I know only what the bibliography says. Particularly about insulin receptors, that tau regulates the phosphorylation of insulin receptors. Yes, it contributes, but it's what I've told in my introduction. I do not know whether that's the main trigger of pathology.
The reason that I ask this question is to ask whether you have thought that changes in the glycosylation of serine 238 or affect, of course you saw that, are being affected by changes in glucose metabolism. Because you said that if you change glycosylation of serine 238, then you don't get phosphorylation. And phosphorylation 238 is pathological.
Yes.
Is it, can you draw, let's say, a cascade of events? Like, can you say that we have changes in glucose metabolism, which leads to changes in glycosylation of tau, and then to changes in phosphorylation?
What's the evidence that glucose metabolism affects glycosylation of tau? Are they connected? I don't know.
No.
Not aware of such an evidence or what governs tau glycosylation. I'm not sure that we know the rules of the game here.
If I can contribute, there is evidence that various types of stresses affect this type of glycosylation of cytoplasmic proteins, and probably tau also.
Of course, it seems logical that maybe normal tau is glycosylated at serine 238, and then something happens and becomes deglycosylated and then phosphorylated. But that's a good theory.
Can I say something?
Yes.
We cannot study this. Spiros, I think, is alluding to something very, very a simple experiment that we've actually talked about, but we can do, which is, If the metabolic process affects phosphorylation, then we can raise the flies in restrictive diets, less sugar or whatever, or more yeast, and we can actually see whether that goes towards phosphorylation or glycosylation. Unfortunately, we cannot see that N type of glycosylation in Drosophila. That's human only. And okay, Perhaps we can do this with a mouse model, that now that we have it, but we haven't in the fly. It's very difficult to do. We can't do it.
Yeah, Mikey, you're right. This is what I was going to.
Yes, I thought so. Somebody else?
Can I also join? Thanks, Katerina, for the nice and simple presentation. Because some of the questions you are trying, you and Makis are trying to address all these years, are very fundamental, not only for the functional tau, because I know you're interested in that, but the function of tau leads us to understand what is wrong in pathology. And what it wrongs can mean, for me, it's not only loss of function, can also gain of function. And I think you nicely see this fundamental question in the field of Alzheimer's disease, which parts of neurodegeneration are attributed to the loss of normal function of tau. And you saw us novel evidence, both in both models you're using in the lab, together with Makis on fly and on mouse, but also some evidence how this can be connected with the gain of function. And then you start also moving to the Alzheimer's disease brain itself. Now, my question, you think that in the process of the disease, in the many years we see for this neurodegeneration, that in your question is tau, and you know how much I like your work and how much I am Taoist. But my question is that, do you think what could be the first, in a way that you see that loss of normal function of tau has a lot of, I see a lot of transcription effect, but later on time, I see also mitochondrial energy that could also fit with, with what Spiros was saying just right 2 minutes ago. So how you see these sequential events that takes years in a human brain, okay, that's why we model it. So time, it doesn't matter in that case. But what you think is the sequence of events between the loss, which part of what you're seeing in your studies, it comes from the loss of tau, and what's part from the gain of toxic aggregation, let's say, or other type of toxicity that comes with tau?
That's a very hard question to answer.
It was a long question.
Who really knows the answer? Please tell me.
You have very nice data. That's why I'm asking. I know it's 1 million questions, but what do you think? What is your feeling based on this data? Because you clearly saw that loss of tau drives to transcription effects. So there is a starvation of synapses. There's starvation of function based on that.
I just want to share a thought, that in mice, for example, a loss of tau didn't produce any major phenotypes, maybe because of functional redundancy. But when tau is not there, then you can see a huge protective impact of models of depression, of epilepsy, of A-beta models.
Exactly.
I think that means that tau just needs to be there also, that it enables things to happen.
Toxicity, yes. Yeah, I fully agree.
So it is the present. So that's why I was telling that, because the cascade of events is very complicated. Yes, it is also phosphorylation, but it's not only phosphorylation. And it's the 85 settings and theramines. God help us. And we are looking only at 10 of them.
So you think that for human use, let's say in future, okay, that's your dream, but you think we should go away from phosphorylation and we focus on diagnostic help, not really diagnostic tool, but as a help to go away from phosphorylation, go to
unless you have all 85 phospho antibodies to look at all of them and then try to understand what's going on. Because when you look only at 10 of them, maybe you are missing the whole picture,
I can bug in for a second, because I have some slightly different point of view, if you like. So first of all, we don't know, to answer Yanis' question, we don't know whether the gain or loss of function has to do with all six isoforms in humans. First, we need to identify what each isoform does. And this is what Katerina talked about with the flies that don't have tau, and we're trying to put in the human tau to see what each human tau isoform does in isolation. So it is a complicated story, and if it wasn't, it would have been solved a long time ago, Yanni. So I think first,
isoform
does, then we can figure out whether its loss or its upregulation is pathogenic or not, one at a time. Then comes the interesting point of view. When you do statistics, you know, you can look at one parameter, the other parameter, then when you have to look at more than one, the statistics get very, very messy. And it will get messy when we start thinking about two isoforms or three isoforms at the same time in the same cell. Which one causes gain, which one causes loss of function, and what are they? Nobody says that when you hyperphosphorylate one isoform, the other stays about, the other isoforms stay around and do nothing, right? Or they are affected in an opposite way. So in my view, in order to answer this question, the first question one needs to answer is, what the heck does every isoform do? Are isoforms that do very specific things with respect to all the issues that you raised, metabolism, stress, hyperphosphorylation, all of these kinds of things. And then we can figure out what they do when they're missing or hyper or overexpressed, right? I mean, the models in flies can help in part. The models in mice could help if you put back isoforms one at a time, but the expense of doing that is prohibitive at the moment. I've been involved in discussions about all these kinds of things, and what we can do in the fly in a year, a mouse approach needs a decade. So, but it's a great question, but where are you gonna start looking at the answer? From what end? I think we consciously approach this by the classic reductionist approach, one isoform at a time in a fly null background or in a fly tau plus background. And we're not ready to tell you the results, but they're very, very interesting at the moment.
Thank you.
I have to just bug in. Anybody else, guys? I don't have any chat messages, so.
What about the mitochondria?
Ah.
And again, whether you can connect the changes in mitochondria and its genes with glucose metabolism.
So we are starting to look at mitochondria. I can tell you that at 12 days, mitochondria are dysfunctional. We have measured mitochondrial activity. Glucose metabolism, we don't know yet.
12 days of overexpression, correct?
Yes.
12 days of overexpression.
Yes. Whereas at 4 days, they are functional, the mitochondria are functional. When we purify mitochondria, tau is there with them. And there is a recent paper that has been published and has showed that tau is not only with mitochondria, it's inside mitochondria. And I think we are trying to characterize the interaction, that's true. But I don't have yet much more to say.
So is tau a mitochondrial protein also?
From what we know so far, no, it's not. What do you mean mitochondria?
I mean, you said that it can be found within mitochondria.
Yes, it's a very recent paper, just came out a week ago. So they just saw tau in the mitochondria, but they don't say what it's doing there. Okay. So it's very new, that finding. It's very interesting. Way.
1 minute, I'll leave you. Can these results find a biotechnological application, let's say?
Such as?
Let's say, I mean, examine a drug based on your results? Can we target a process pharmacologically? I don't know if Costas Demetzos is here. That's Anna, I see him. That's why I asked this question.
Okay.
In case you find that, do you think that serine 238, for example, should be targeted somehow with a drug or how?
So the serine 238, very nice question. And which one we should target, we think? Serine 238 or its gatekeeper, serine 262?
Okay. Which one you will choose and how you will target it?
We know that serine 262 is phosphorylated by PAR1.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe we could target PAR1, let's say.
Mm-hmm.
So in order to target the phosphorylation site, we need first to understand their interplay. In order for serine 262 to be phosphorylated, threonine 245 needs to be phosphorylated. If it's not phosphorylated, then serine 262 becomes phosphorylated. So you know it's a very complicated game, that of phosphorylation sites, I think. And I'm sure that a kinase can phosphorylate too many phosphocytes, not just one. So I don't think that we have that great specificity for the kinases. So I'm trying to say that the interplay of phosphocytes is, it's very complicated. So what we want to target is, okay.
We can do that, Spiro. But not with the classic inhibitors. We need monoclonal antibodies or antibodies that can actually target specific phosphocytes. That would be the...
To increase specificity.
With phosphospecific specificity, and to solve the questions of when do we apply the antibodies and where would they be? Would they be in the fly? You can put them inside the cell or outside the cell. I mean, do you cut tau when it spreads or do you cut tau when it's inside the cell? What do you need? So those are fundamental questions that actually have pertinence to therapeutics. And we can do that in flies, and believe me, we are. But no clear answer yet. If there are no more questions, guys, let's... Thank you, Katerina. Thanks for attending.
Thank you all for being here.
For all those that are in the country, Kalitsik Nopemti. For all those that are overseas, we're thinking of you.
Ευχαριστούμε πολύ.
Ευχαριστούμε, Κατερίνα.
Να είστε καλά. Γεια σε όλους σας.
Γεια σας.
Γεια σας.
Γεια, γεια. Thank you.